Thanks very much. Thanks very much, Sarah. It's really lovely being back in Leeds. It's exciting. It's terrific. And the talk today, the talk is really, I suppose, dedicated to Dr. Vicky Habermehl. whose exam today was the stimulus that brought me here, and a very nice stimulus too. And the title of the talk is Greece, Hope Drowns in the Sea of Reality, or Does It? And it's also got a subtitle, or a different title, which is No, No, No. Not to be confused with No, John, No, John, No. Just No, 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 simply No. Three no's, three dates, okay? 5th of July, 2015, the 6th of December, 2008, and the 15th of December, 2008. So the first no is the no. The first no is, must be, has to be, the no, the great ohi of the referendum in Greece of the 5th of July. A night when all the world danced in the streets. An absurd no. No, when 62% of the voters voted against acceptance of the terms offered by the Eurozone leaders. A great no, an absurd, ridiculous no, a no of hope, a no of dignity. Writing in 1795, William Blake imagined the reactions of the kings of Asia to the revolutionary upsurge in Europe. He imagined the kings calling to their counselors, calling on their counselors to cut off the bread from the city that the remnant may learn to obey, that the pride of the heart may fail, that the lust of the eyes may be quenched, that the delicate ear in its infancy may be dulled and the nostrils closed up, to teach mortal worms the path that leads from the gates of the grave. I think the prolonged negotiation between the Eurozone governments and Syriza was really that, not just a negotiation, but a very conscious humiliation, an attempt to kill the pride of the heart, to teach mortal words the path that worms, the path that leads from the gates of the grave. And the no of the 5th of July was really a no to the humiliation, a flaring of the nostrils, a sharpening of the ears, an awakening of the lust of the eyes, a cry that shouts to the four winds. With no disrespect for the worms, we are really more than that. And there is more to life than the march to the grave. The great no of the referendum did not lead anywhere, we know. Perhaps it could not lead anywhere. The governments of the Eurozone, including now the Syriza government in Greece, joining with the other 18, replied just over a week later, on the 13th of July, sorry, I think Syriza probably said, very sorry. But you have it wrong. The reality of the world is that there is no space for the no. What is this word, no? That is nonsense. That is silly speak. That is the language of a world of make-believe. The reality is that the choice in the referendum was between yes and yes. The reality is that there is no other option other than conforming. A disaster, of course, those of us who jumped for joy on the 5th of July, and I assume that includes many or most, or I hope all of us here. Certainly it was true in Mexico. We literally jumped for joy when we heard the results. Those, and then we wept, literally or metaphorically, on the 13th of July, feeling a no drowned, a hope smothered. And yet, it remains our starting point, the point from which we try to understand the world. It remains our starting point partly because the joy of the no of the 5th of July is not contained in the depression of the yes imposed on the 13th of July. It remains our starting point because it is still the constant topic of conversation in Greece. But I think it's more than that. I think it remains our starting point because that no is our language. In that no is our language, our grammar, our reality. In that no, we recognize ourselves. And in that no, we search for our own humanity. And is this an exaggeration? I don't actually think it is an exaggeration. Because Syriza's slogan before their election in January of this year was "Hope is coming." And then as soon as the results were announced and they won, they announced, "This is the victory of hope." And then I think after 5 months of negotiations, the referendum remained a symbol of hope that things could be different, and not only in Greece. And the agreement that followed, the agreement of the 13th of July, hit us so hard because it was very explicitly a message of closure to the world. It was a message that said, there is no hope. There is only reality. A message that I think has been taken up by Zizek, for example, in a recent article in the New Statesman entitled "The Courage of Hopelessness." He suggests that after the defeat in Greece, we must now have the courage of hopelessness, the courage to give up, in other words. And I think that is actually what we're confronted with. No, I mean, this, it's not that I agree with Zizek, very, very far from it. But I think the merit of his article is that he is saying, look, this is the end. This is the end of our dreams of a radically different world. We must now have the courage of hopelessness. we must now have the courage to deal with reality as it is. Seems to me that that is completely unacceptable, firstly. And secondly, that it involves no courage at all, because that is actually what we learn from the very first day of primary school. The whole education system tells us, tries to teach us, the courage of hopelessness, the courage to accept that no, capitalism is the unchangeable framework within which we live. Any idea of a radically different society is so much nonsense. And that is a closure, it seems to me. I mean, if one were to adopt that position, it would be a closure on political action. No? Would say all this revolutionary thinking is nonsense. But I think it is also, and this addresses us directly, I suppose, in the universities, it is a closure of thought. Because if you talk of the structure of hopelessness, if you say that there can be no world beyond capitalism, then you are saying that our categories, we must put on the blinkers of bourgeois thought. We must put on the blinkers that say, well, this is permanent. This society is permanent. In other words, we must abandon all idea of the historicity of present-day society and present-day categories. We must abandon all idea of form. In other words, that the categories of thought are historically specific forms generated by this society. I think the no of the 5th of July, followed by the dreadful yes of the agreement of the 13th of July, does in fact confront us with those issues. The 5th of July, the great no of the referendum, derived its force, it seems to me, from an earlier no. This is my second no. The no of the 6th of December of 2008. The 6th of December of 2008 was, of course, the day on which the police shot the 15-year-old Alexis Grigoropoulos in Athens. And this provoked one of the loudest screams of no that has been heard in this century. No to police violence, no to discrimination against the young, against migrants, against women, no to a system built on frustration, no to a system that dulls our senses, closes our nostrils through unemployment, and sometimes even worse, through employment. No to a system built upon the meaningless of money. No, too, to the stale traditions of working class struggle. There were no, in the months and months of riots and marches and protests that followed, there were no demands made of the state. It was just a roar of fury against the state and all that it stood for. Rage was interlaced with hope, but the relation was fragile and there was no institutional mediation. It was not a hope that change would come through the next election. It was not that at that time. But there was an underlying hope that the world could be different, that it might be possible to bring down the world of capital and repression and injustice, that it might be possible to create something radically different. one of the many manifestos circulating in the streets of Athens in those days gives a feeling for the movement. And I quote, "The revolt was, in fact, a revolt against property and alienation. Whoever did not hide behind the curtains of their privacy, whoever found themselves in the streets, knows this very well. Shops were looted, not to resell the computers, the clothes, the furniture, but for the enjoyment of the catastrophe of that which alienates us, the phantasmagoria of the commodity. The pyres that heated the bodies of the insurgents in the long nights of December were full of products of our labor liberated, disarmed symbols of a once powerful imaginary. We simply took that which belongs to us and threw it on the fires, together with all it signifies. The great potlatch of the previous days was a rebellious desire against the imposed canon of scarcity. This revolt was, in fact, a rebellion against property and alienation, a revolt of the gift against the sovereignty of money, an insurrection of anarchy, of use value against the democracy of exchange value, a spontaneous rising of collective freedom against the rationality of individual discipline." Obviously, that manifesto is not necessarily representative in any strict sense, but it does give a feeling, I think, for the issues and the kind of the tonality of the movements of those days. And I think the striking thing is that the movement spoke a language that does not fit. It spoke the language of a world that does not exist yet, and therefore exists not yet in our revolts. And in the years of marches and protests and riots and repression that followed, some of that rage led on to the search for other ways of living through the creation of social centers, community gardens, factory occupations, local assemblies, and so on, both as ways of tackling immediate practical problems, namely, how do you survive, and also creating the basis for a different possible world. But the protests and the experiments of those years brought their difficulties and their frustrations. The hundreds of protests made absolutely no impact on government policy. The 12th of February 2012, for example, when hundreds of thousands of people demonstrated in the streets, when more than 50 buildings were burnt down in the center of Athens, when police cars were set on fire, when tear gas was used far beyond the legal limits, the parliament was surrounded by a police guard, and the deputies voted to approve the budget cuts imposed by the Troika. And I think that after that, inevitably, arose the question of, well, then what? Where do you go? What do you do? And I think it is against this background that you have to account for the spectacular rise of Syriza. I think it's important to see that Syriza was, in a sense, the product of the weakness of more radical alternative movements. Syriza was something that seemed to offer a way forward in that situation. They said, coming out of the movement in many senses. They said, vote for us, and we shall really make things different. We shall break with the austerity policies imposed by one government after another. We shall stop the repression and the corruption. So after 6 years of rioting and creating alternatives that had made little difference, now it was time to make hope effective, to give it a realistic way forward. In other words, Syriza inherited the legacy of those years of militancy and focused it, and in the process, transformed it. I think this is, for me, something we have to think about, because it changed the grammar of the protests and brought it closer to the grammar of orthodox politics. So that the protests of 2008 and the years that followed moved on the edge of impossibility and invention. It was always on the edge of a hopeless despair, but there was a hope there, a hope that refused to come to terms with the existing system, a hope that could only be an absolute call for a different world and a rejecting of this one. And the rise of Syriza gave a definition to hope, but in the process, it narrowed it down, so that the enemy now was not capitalism, but neoliberalism, understood as the dominance of a particularly aggressive form of capitalism. The demand was for the ending of austerity. So the end of capitalism was set aside as being entirely unrealistic. As Varoufakis, later Minister for Finance, explained in a talk in Zagreb in 2013, the end of capitalism might be desirable in the long term, but the aim now must be to fight for changes within the system. And he spoke of a repugnant European capitalism whose implosion, despite its many ills, should be avoided at all costs. So this was to be a realistic politics. And part of that change of grammar, and it seems to me that this is really perhaps, I don't know, the frightening bit. Well, no, it's all frightening. No? This strikes me as being particularly frightening. Part of that change of grammar, and it seems to be an inevitable consequence of focusing this faction and hope on the state, was that this dissatisfaction and hope became territorialized in a way that wasn't present in the earlier movement. Okay, so that the riots and marches of 2008 afterwards were clearly directed against the Greek government and against the system. The struggle, although of course the Troika and the European Union were there in the background, the struggle did not present itself in national terms. This was a rebellion of use value against value, not of Greece against Germany. But once Syriza came to power in the election in January, the conflict came to be redefined, that not necessarily because the Syriza leaders were racist, but it came to be redefined as a conflict between Greece and the other countries of the Eurozone. The conflicts move from the cities to the state, from the streets to the closed rooms of interstate negotiation. And in a sense, Greece itself is constituted politically and conceptually in that process. And that seems to me very important to underline, because that translation, that process of redefinition of the social conflict in terms of a national conflict feeds, especially now after the failure of the Syriza government, it feeds directly into the growth of nationalism, both in Greece and throughout Europe. And one thing that has been shocking me over the last few weeks, I think, is just reading the number of Marxist comments on the situation in Greece, or the number of radical comments on the situation in Greece, that present us entirely in national terms, saying in one article, for example, the problem is not Greece, the problem is Germany. And that seems to me really dreadful, really, really appalling, no, really frightening, no. So the really exciting, I mean, if you think of it in that way, then the really exciting thing about the referendum of the 5th of July was not just that it was saying the people were saying no. It wasn't that they were suggesting a policy alternative. In a sense, they were returning to the language of 2008 and afterwards. It was a no. That wasn't a policy proposal. It was simply no. No, no, we will not accept. Not a no that was contained within the logic of the state. It was a break with the logic that Syriza had been building up over the months. And even if many people felt that Grexit, the exit from the Eurozone, might be some sort of solution, it was being expressed not as a policy proposal for which preparations must be made, but really as simply as a polite way of throwing a rock through a bank. Really a polite way of saying, well, we hate you all. No? And of course, then it became clear that this realism that had been preached by the Syriza government, the Syriza party and then the Syriza government for so much time, was absolutely, totally unrealistic. It had no chance of succeeding. And then what it did was to lead the anger, the hope of the previous years onto the path of realism, but it didn't actually come in contact with the real world. Because Syriza still dreamed of a fairer capitalism. It fought for months for this realistic dream that was absolute fantasy. And this ended, of course, in the tragical, farcical capitulation by Syriza to the reality represented by Angela Merkel and the other politicians of the European Union, who had been saying really from the beginning, grow up, no? Get real. Or as Christine Lagarde said, no, in one moment, oh, it would be nice to talk with just adults in the room. No. In other words, this whole thing about, you know, the whole realistic promise of Syriza just wasn't realistic at all. Merkel was saying, in reality, there is no hope. Why don't you understand? There is no hope. There is no such thing as a fairer capitalism. Keynes is dead. And Syriza's great merit, I suppose, was it pushed, its merit was that it was stupid in a sense. Its merit was that it was very slow to learn and that pushed this fantasy realism to its limits and failed. And reality won and hope was defeated. That's real, that's what we're living in. That's what we have to take, somehow think about, confront. Reality won and hope was defeated. Except that if we remember the 6th of December, then we remember that no, it was their reality that won. It was their hope as well, Sirius's hope, that was defeated. Our reality is a different reality. Our reality is the reality of a world that exists not yet, a world of creativity, not of frustration, a world of life and not of death. Our reality is the rebellion of use value against value. But can we eat it? That's the problem. And to understand more about their reality, the reality that won, that stands triumphant, the reality that effectively told and tells Syriza and Podemos and, I suppose, Jeremy Corbyn, that they're just stupid little children, quite rightly, perhaps, or perhaps not. To understand what that reality is, it's important, I think, to return to mention our third note and our third no, sorry, and our third date. And the third date is the 15th of September of 2008, the date on which the Lehman Brothers bank collapsed. The biggest bankruptcy in the history of capitalism, which brought panic to the world of finance and the world of politics. So that Tim Geithner, later US Treasury Secretary, said the United States risked a complete collapse of our financial system. And many other politicians and many other of the leading economic and financial journalists echoed the same message. And the collapse was eventually avoided by the great bailout of banks. Throughout the world, there was a massive nationalization, not of the banks themselves, but of the debts of the banks. And it seems that worldwide, $20 trillion, that is $20 million, were pumped into the banks to keep them afloat, which of course transformed the bank debt, the enormous bank debt, into an enormous state debt. And it was where before it was clear that the banks would not be able to pay their debts, it now became clear that many states would not be able to pay the debts they had acquired. And this made it necessary for the states to do everything possible to pay the creditors, the banks, of course, by adopting policies of austerity, that is, by cutting welfare payments and selling off state-owned assets. So that according to David McNally, writing in 2010, in response to market reactions to its debt, Latvia has fired one third of all teachers and slashed pensions by 70%. Ireland has chopped wages of government employees by 22%. The state of California has cut health insurance for 900,000 children. We all know, we all recognize, we can all think of lots of other examples. We all recognize that that is what has been happening around the world. In other words, despite the drama of the last few months, Greece is not really so special. No? The measures that the Syriza government has been forced to accept are actually not very different from the reforms that are being implemented in most parts of the world. Labor reform, cutting the rights of the workers, reduction of pensions, cuts in the welfare systems, education reform, privatization of state resources previously considered to be crucial, the hollowing out of democracy, etc., etc. The Zapatistas have suggested that a terrible storm is blowing against the world, and they called a conference, they called a seminar in at the beginning of May to try and understand why, where this storm was coming from and what we could do. Seen from this perspective then, Greece is important not because it is on its own, not at all, simply because it is in the center of the storm. But it is clear that what is happening in Greece can be understood only if we try to understand the storm as a whole. So the problem is not this state or that state, but capital. That is the way in which relations between people are currently organized, the subjection of human activity to the logic of profit. This form of organization is inherently antagonistic because it depends upon the subordination of people's activity to a logic that we do not control. And this antagonism inevitably means instability. Capital depends upon being able to subordinate us, that is to subordinate our day-to-day activity to its logic, to its demands, which means that our possible lack of subordination, the possibility that we might say, oh, you know, today I don't feel like going to work, or today I've got other things to do. That possible lack of subordination always stands as a threat to capital, as potential crisis of capital. So that the collapse of the Lehman Brothers Bank shows not only, or explains the, not only the intensification of capitalist aggression, the storm in all the world, but also suggests that this aggression is actually grounded in the fragility of the system. So the constant preoccupation of the politicians, I think of all politicians, is and must be, how do we ensure the reproduction of the capitalist system? Exactly what Varoufakis said in Zagreb. You know, we hate it, we know capitalism is awful, but how do we prevent its implosion? They prevented its implosion on the 13th of July, perfectly logical. And they have to see the world in those terms because their position prevents them from even imagining what is perfectly obvious. No? They can't even imagine what is perfectly obvious, even though we shout it at them all the time and must shout it at them all the time. Namely, that capitalism has failed, that capitalism exists now as a threat to the future of human life, that capitalism exists now as a threat to the existence of many forms of life on this planet, and that it is extinguishing. There is a massacre of non-human species taking place, and indeed a massacre of humans. So capitalism is dying, but it is not yet clear whether we will all die with it, which is we have to face as a very real possibility, or whether we will be able to create something before it brings us down. And the collapse, or the near collapse, of the financial system in 2008 suggests, firstly, that capitalism, or sorry, that the negotiations over the last few months and the desperate insistence of the Eurozone governments that they could not accept the terms being asked for by the Greek government seems to say to me, firstly, it is the admission that the system is unstable. And secondly, they are saying very clearly, we are the problem. We are the ones who need to be restructured. That's what the negotiation is about. And very explicitly, it's the question of what terms can we impose upon the people of Greece? How can we restructure Greek life? How can we impose discipline? How can we stop those young Greeks from going out so late at night? How do we stop older Greeks from still wanting to sleep siestas in the afternoon? How do we do that? Not only how do we do it, but why do we do it? We do it because we know that that is the problem. We know that we are failing at the moment to impose the discipline that we as representatives of capital require. And capital's problem is not just that it depends on us, but that it depends on the constant intensification of our subordination. It is not just that money rules, but that the rule of money has a dynamic that forces capital to make us produce things and circulate things more and more and more quickly, more and more efficiently. Capital cannot stand still. In order to survive, it has to constantly intensify the subordination of every aspect of human life. Unlike any other form of domination, capital is driven by its own inadequacy. And the difficulty of achieving this is reflected in the long-term growth of debt. Debt is essentially a game of make-believe. Debt is capital saying, well, if we're not able to impose the discipline that we need for our own survival, we'll pretend that we can, and we'll make money, we'll make symbols of wealth that do not actually correspond to the wealth that we are managing to produce. So Tim Coggan, for example, comments, in the last 40 years, the world has been more successful at creating claims on wealth than it has at creating wealth itself. The economy has grown, but asset prices have risen faster and debts have risen faster still. Debtors, from speculative home buyers to leading governments, have made promises that they are unlikely to meet in full. Creditors who are counting on those debts to be repaid will be disappointed. In fact, it's been going on for more than 40 years. Debt has become a central element of the reproduction of capital. So that the difficulty of reconciling the social pressures that arise in the end from the humanity of humans with capital's need to dehumanize us and make us into machines for producing profit is reflected in the ever-expanding breach between the creation of wealth and the creation of the symbols of wealth, in other words, the creation of debt. And this obviously creates a fierce scramble, a vicious and bloody game of musical chairs as creditors fight to make sure that debts are paid, and debtors fight to try and push the burden of the debt onto somebody else. And it seems to me that neoliberalism is simply the political expression of a world in which capital is dominated by and threatened by this enormous expansion of debt. So that neoliberalism is not a policy chosen by governments. It is simply the violence of the game that they are forced to play, the viciousness of the world in which they exist. So all governments are forced by their position to try to make sure to provide the best conditions for accumulation in their own territories, and also to try to make sure that the roof, which is bound to collapse somewhere, falls somewhere else and not on it, so that it must fall not in Berlin or Frankfurt or London or Leeds, but it's all right if it falls in Athens or Thessaloniki or Zimbabwe or Detroit, who knows where it is exactly, or Puerto Rico. No? So that the violence of the game, is of the capitalist game, just is not the same as it was 50 years ago, when the conditions created by fascism, by the slaughter of about 100 million people in the Second World War, and the fear of communism had created a space for some sort of welfare capitalism. And I think what the negotiations are telling us, it's not just a question of political preferences, it's not just a question of the Eurozone. What the negotiations are telling us seem to be, this is really the message being spelled out by the European politicians, is that there is no longer any possibility of a less aggressive capitalism. And you can see the negotiations, the 5 months of negotiations, as being a sort of classroom, no, in which Merkel and Schäuble, as teachers, tried to teach Tsipras, and at first Varoufakis as well, what it means to lead a state in today's capitalism. And they had to explain to him patiently. They say, Look, Kostakis, Keynes is dead. He's long dead. Forget about creating a benevolent capitalism. Forget about creating a fairer system. There is no room for that. As the leader of the state, you must understand that you have to implement aggressive neoliberal policies in order to attract capital to your frontiers. And their pupil was rather stupid, very slow, and at last, on the 13th of July, he learnt, and now, of course, Syriza is committed to implementing exactly the neoliberal policies that were demanded of them. And if you think of it like that, then it becomes clear that Grexit, the Greek exit from the Eurozone wouldn't really be an answer. I mean, Grexit is attractive just because it would be a kind of punch in the face for the European politicians, but it wouldn't. I mean, it's attractive as a way of shouting no, as a way of continuing the no of the 5th of July, but it wouldn't actually make an awful lot of difference if one begins to think of it in terms of a policy of how do we go out of the Eurozone and how will we restructure capital in Greece and how will we again create conditions that are attractive for capitalist investment, because Grexit would still involve almost and certainly labor reform, educational reform, cutting pensions, privatizations, etc. So the third no, this no of the 15th of September 2008, is certainly a no, it doesn't work. It's not a no of fury and rage. It's a no, capitalism doesn't work. But in a way, it is related to the earlier no's as well, because the debt, the massive extension of debt in the world really arises from people saying, no, we will not become robots. They often say it very quietly, no, we will not become robots. Or no, we are not willing to, or perhaps we're just too stupid or too backward to satisfy the demands of capital. So the near collapse of the banking system is, strangely perhaps, I think, an expression of our strength, of the strength of our everyday lives and habits, the strength of everyday politics. It is the vengeance, in a way, of our reality, a reality that says, just a minute, let me finish my breakfast. Or a reality that says, well, I'd really like to spend a bit more time with the children. A reality of thinking about other things, of being unsure of ourselves, of being unable to do what is asked of us, of being a little bit too stupid or a little bit too young or a little bit too old, a reality of not speaking the right language, a reality of falling in love, a reality of wanting to go to the beach in the summer, a reality of creating or thinking of alternatives. That is really what constitutes the crisis of capital. So the capitalists are quite right to blame us for capital's crisis. And we must respond, yes, we are the crisis of capital and proud of it. We are proud of it because the crisis of a system built upon death and destruction is the only hope for the future of humanity. And how absurd. And I think that's really my main conclusion. It's really that we must have the courage, not the courage of hopelessness, but the courage of our own absurdity. The courage of saying, well, yes, we don't fit in. The courage to say, well, no, our conception of the future of the world is not in terms of faster rates of growth each year. Our idea of the future and what the way we would like to do it is something completely different. And if we're not sure what it is, then that doesn't matter, because we're all going to have an assembly or sit down and think about it and think about how we would shape the world. So our sense of the future of the world is not a democracy that exists actually, no, the moment that is just made total nonsense of an object of derision and mockery by the agreement of the 13th of July. No. We must, I think, have the courage to say, here in the universities, what we are trying to work out, what we are trying to think through, what we are trying to teach is confidence in our own absurdity, because that is the only possible way forward. Thank you very much. I can share my own questions, and then if I can share the questions. If I don't like them, then I'll. Okay. Yes. Are there? I suppose there are no questions, that everybody agrees, no? But just in case, comments rather than questions. Shall we take them three by three? It seems to me it's probably better. Yeah. Okay.
I think it's important to disagree. I think the way in which he formulated the relationship between state and capital was very problematic. The noise that you talked about, 2008, the riots of 2012 and such like, the collapse of Lehman Brothers in 2008 and the riots of 2012, what they show is that the state is a kind of focal nodal point of capitalist social relations. And consequently, the need to move the social movement from 2008-2012 in a direction that challenges that is, I think, an entirely positive one. The problem is that Syriza's way of doing that was to reproduce old forms of reformist, at best left reformist social democracy. Perry Anderson in The Jacobin describes Syriza's capitulation on the 13th as being like 1914. It wasn't like 1914, because all of us who understood the problem of statist politics understood that 1914, it was going to happen. There was a shock in 1914. It wasn't a shock. It was a bit of a shock. It was so quick on 13th of July, but it wasn't that much of a shock. So the problem is, politically, how do we move the movement, the fragmented movements that we see 2008, 12? One thing I think missing from your overview was the number of general strikes in Greece, which were incredibly positive, but also did the thing that you said, didn't get anywhere. But they were mobilising at the same time. How do we move that in a political direction? And I think that there's the positive side of Syriza, but then there's the negative side as well, that it focuses on change within the existing capitalist state, and in particular within the EU, in the EU context. And so consequently, it doesn't give you an answer to which way should socialists and anti-capitalists relate to the coming election in Greece, because I think the election's incredibly important, because it's Tsipras's way of imposing or playing his new role as the guy who's imposing the EU's austerity. And consequently, the shift of, on the one hand, the left platform, popular unity, out of Syriza is a positive, problematic, because it's effectively got the same old politics, and Tazia, much more positive movement. But I think that political side is the weakness in what is otherwise an important, a very important, I think, critique of Syriza that you got, that's also actually relevant to, in its own way, to Corbyn mania over here at the moment.
Yeah. Shall we take three, so that kind of more, I mean, if there are any others, does that make sense? No, or, yeah.
Continue off the poll again, very inspiring talk on one level, but I think the problem is there's one issue. You can have different forms of capitalism. You're saying inherently, they're all going to sell out. I think one of the, where I disagree is that with Corbyn, while I'm a revolutionary socialist and SWP, I'm not going to join the Labour Party, I have no illusion to the parliamentary road to socialism. I think what Corbyn represents in ways inspiring in Britain is that potentially I believe there is a certain space for a breaking with austerity models. Corbyn will have huge amounts of difficulty, even if you got into power. But I think there is a kind of space for a kind of model of some sort of reform, not even for socialism or that, trying to manage this. But I think there's a space there, which is what's inspiring the Corbyn thing, and
I disagree, of course.
So what I was going to say is, if you have to come out of the EU, sorry, to continue on it, Corbyn would have to break from the EU. And just press you a bit more on this question of coming out of the EU, because you say, you know, it doesn't make really a difference. Corbyn would have to, a Labour Party would have to come out of the EU, would have to really stand up to powers of being. And then again, you know, you set the difficulties, it would depend on there being a kind of some of the struggle from below, or a pressure on him, you know, from below, general strikes or whatever you need real pressure on. But I still think potentially you can have a different model.
This is an argument for the Labour Party. Obviously my argument is different. I'm saying I don't think it's adequate to see the 13th of July, the agreement, as being a betrayal by Tsipras. I mean, I do actually think Tsipras should have resigned. I kind of find it hard in a way, in personal terms, perhaps, to understand why he didn't. But I don't think that betrayal helps us a lot, because the notion of betrayal really puts the burden on an individual. And I don't think it was that. I think that to get into a position of running the state means, I think, inevitably entering into the logic of capital. It means entering into the logic which says, in order to survive, we must try and attract capital to our territory. I don't see any state head being able to say anything else. I mean, that seems to me, you know. So it's not a question of betrayal in that sense. It's really a question of a kind of very long and dramatic playing out of that structural constraint. And the amazing thing about Syriza is actually that it lasted so long before caving in. Most governments, most left-wing governments, turn around much faster. And they said, no, 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 we won't accept. And then, of course, in the end, they did accept. I think, for me, that means obviously the end of Syriza as a radical party. That's already clear. I mean, all they can do now, I mean, if they win the election, then they will be forced to implement, they will, of course, be committed to implementing the austerity measures. There is an argument that says that in this particular situation, it would make more sense to vote for Neo Demokratia, because if Syriza comes back, it'll split the opposition to the austerity program. If the right Neo Demokratia wins, then it's actually much more likely that you will get prolonged struggles, both from the trade unions and the state-centered movement, and from the alternative autonomist and anarchist left. So perhaps better for the right to win. It is clear there's going to be a huge abstention, just because so many people, or so many young people, I think, in particular, who were really, in many cases, going against, or certainly against their own habits when they voted in the election of January, will are now saying, no way. So really, I suppose what I'm arguing, I'm kind of arguing various different things. I mean, I think, first of all, that there is, that it really, really poses a dilemma for us all. And of course, we all must and we all do learn from major political things like that. But I think the turnaround between the 5th and the 13th of July really does pose major issues about how we think about politics. Because, firstly, because it confronts those of us who say, well, it's not through the state anyway. No, obviously, we knew from, we can say, oh, yes, we told you so. No, it was clear that when Syriza won, that it wouldn't be able to do anything. But I think that's to miss the point. The point is that the rise of Syriza has to be understood in terms of the weakness, even in Greece, which is, of the autonomous non-statist left. In other words, the weakness, the inability of the non-statist left to say, well, here is an alternative way of living. Because one of the things that is spelt out, really, by the negotiations is, if you want employment, then you must try to attract capital. If you want to attract capital in today's society, then you must implement vicious measures of austerity. Unless you happen to own a massive supply of oil and gas. No, I mean, okay, you may, as in the case of some of the Latin American governments, have the natural resources that allow you to weaken that. But that's not the case, I think, in Greece. So the measure is, if you want employment, that means attract capital. If you want to attract capital, implement neoliberal policies. Which means that if we really want to break with that, we have to say, go to hell, capital. We don't want you here. We don't want your investment. We don't want your employment. We can find other ways to live. And of course, there are millions and millions of people in the world who are trying to develop other means of living, either because they've been pushed out by capital, or because they are convinced that we have to go that way. But it is, what Greece is really saying to us is, even in this politically exciting country, you have not yet reached that situation. So what are you going to do about it? And it seems to me the only thing we can say is, well, no, we haven't reached that situation. So we are caught in a contradictory situation where, on the one hand, we do need employment to live, and therefore we need capital. On the other hand, we are more and more aware than ever of just what a vicious, nasty, deadly system is capitalism is. Therefore, we have to live with our contradictions. Therefore, we have to try and do everything possible to build up, I suppose, our defenses or our possibilities so that the next time that capital says to us, either it is starvation, either it is chaos and starvation, or you accept our diktat, then we have more of an answer. Because it's clear that there will be a next time, and there will be many next times. I mean, firstly, it's clear that the agreement won't work. Everybody knows that. The Greek government may be very successful in imposing measures of austerity, but they're not going to keep up with the debt repayments that they're committed to. And secondly, the financial crisis after Lehman, the expansion of debt goes on. The system continues to be more and more fragile. So of course there are going to be next times. And each next time, each crisis really confronts us with a very real, palpable alternative. And it poses the question, well, do you agree to bow down even more? Do you agree to subordinate your lives even more to the rhythms necessary for capitalist reproduction? Or can you find a way out? Okay, so that seems to me the first problem. And the second thing that the whole Greek drama says to us very clearly is it is not through the state. There can be nothing clearer than that. Syriza, the most exciting party on the left, certainly in Europe, for the last 50-100 years, couldn't do it, despite its massive support, you know. And I just don't, you know, that seems to me the end of Syriza. Logically, it is the end of Podemos as well, you know. And then, of course, the Labour Party closes its eyes and says, we didn't see that, you know. I don't really understand that. Okay, Syriza moved the whole of Greece into more exciting times, more exciting discussions. But you cannot fundamentally reform the system through the state. That is what that is what they're telling us. And then Zizek says, in a way, quite logically, okay, then that's it. You know, let's now have the courage of hopelessness. Forget about your Marxist theory. Forget about your radical theory that looked for creating a different sort of world. Forget about all that anti-globalization claptrap about another world is possible. No, Zizek is saying very clearly, no, another world is not possible. Put on your blinkers, close your minds, close your eyes. You know, students, forget about that. Teachers, forget about that. This is really the Greek crisis, really good. No, think, confront it. Sorry.
Yeah, no, I was just thinking, are you sort of suggesting that we conserve our energy a little bit in small acts of resistance rather than going all out? I mean, personally, I think anarchy's lost its quality than applying to governments to march, you know, all that kind of stuff. It's all about singing, everything's part. So what's the answer? What's your suggesting? We just say, right, I'm not going to do 40 hours, I'm only going to do 30,
Does anybody do 40 anymore?
Well.
Yeah, I don't know. I think we have to say, well, we don't know what the answer is. You know, this is really confronting us with a crisis, a problem. You know, we know what capital's answer is. We know that the austerity measures that it requires, we know what it's doing to inequality. We know what it's doing to education. We know what it's doing to public health. We know what it means in terms of police increasing authoritarianism. We know what it means in terms of police violence. We in Mexico and in the whole world know what Ayotzinapa means, the disappearance of the 43 students almost a year ago. That's what it means. You know, and then what do we do? Well, we don't know what to do. Greece is telling us, well, we don't know what to do. To which we say, either we close our eyes and just have the courage of hopelessness, or we say, well, we don't know what to do, therefore let's talk about it. But let's at least think about the issues. And let's think as well, let's think about the importance of the material basis of radical politics and of autonomous movements, because in a way, yes, if you see Greece as the most exciting place in terms of autonomous movements, anti-state protests, but there is a question in the end, you know, can you eat it? Can you eat it? If you have to go and, okay, you can go and burn down the center of Athens on Saturday, you know, but what do you do on Monday? Do you go and say, please, I want a job, or what? You know, and there is a real question, you know, how do we think? I mean, again, if you think of the Zapatistas, the beautiful, glorious Zapatistas, no? Who've been doing this for what? Nearly 33 years. Yes, they can hold out. You know, they can say, well, no, we don't accept capital. No, we won't accept the logic of the of money, and we won't accept the logic of the state. Finally, because they have their own land and they can cultivate and live in a poverty that we would find difficult to cope with, but, you know, they can live on it. So then what does that mean to us in the cities, no? In the contested cities, because all cities are contested, I suppose. Now, how do we actually think, you know, because the crisis will come again in different places where they say very explicitly, you know, bow down even more. That's what the negotiations are. They're saying to the Greek people, accept things that you wouldn't have dreamed of accepting 10 years ago. Either that or it's chaos and hunger. And that will come again. Maybe in Greece, quite likely. Maybe in other places. And then the question is, well, what do we do? And we say, well, we don't know. We're not, you know. You can say build a party if you like, but that won't help us very much. You know, the question is really, well, what do we do?
I wanted to sort of ask you about a couple of things that you said through the kind of lens of migration and borders. Obviously, just because it's something I and I know a lot of other people have been thinking about constantly these last few weeks in terms of what's been happening in Europe. So I guess the first thing is like that you said that each crisis presents itself with an alternative. That's the way you formulated it just now. And the crisis of, you know, the crisis of migration, the crisis of borders in Europe at the moment, I guess, obviously, and obviously in Greece particularly, presents itself as the alternative of mass incarceration, deportation, you know, very forms of, you know, bare life and that kind of thing, as well as another Europe is possible, as some of the Germans have it, you know, of open borders, of, you know, all the good things. And the other thing I was thinking about in relation to migration was the way you talked about the transmutation of the struggle in Greece from, yeah, the idea of the people versus capital and the state to you know, Germany versus Greece and blah, blah, blah. And it struck me that that's obviously playing out in a very interesting way in terms of the border crisis.
Indeed.
And the way in which Germany sees itself now as the benevolent... the harbour of refugees, the opener of the border.
Yes.
And, you know, and this week, Hungary is the bogeyman. And I mean, all these things have, you know, real historical truth surrounding them. This isn't just the way the capital plays out. But I wondered whether you had any thoughts about the kind of the border crisis at the moment in relation to the way that you're talking about Greece and using Greece as a way of talking about everything else.
Not really. I suppose what it obviously makes very clear. I haven't really thought about it, I suppose, is the answer. I think what it makes very clear is what is always true, that is just the the deadly nature of borders. Well, I suppose firstly, the deadly nature of borders. I mean, we tend, you know, and those of us who have passports and can travel around fairly easily tend to forget it, but borders are obviously places for people keeping out, for keeping people out. And keeping people out means a lot of violence and a lot of death and a lot of misery. But the number of Mexicans deported from the United States is some absolutely incredible figure of what, about 100,000 a month? Or, I mean, it's something absolutely unbelievable. You know, and the number of people who die trying to cross the border each year is, what, it's in its thousands, I think. You know, okay. And then with the present refugee crisis, obviously that has hit has become unsustainable. I mean, they just cannot maintain that exclusion of so many people in the present situation. So they're have been forced to be more flexible. How long that will be maintained, I don't know. I mean, I'm sure there must be lots of Colombians and Peruvians and Hondurans thinking, oh, right, we'll get on the first boat to Europe, which is now so generous. And I suspect that they're likely to be very disappointed indeed, no? I mean, I can only see this as kind of what's happening at the moment, I suppose, is a momentary attempt to deal with an unsustainable situation and to reconstitute borders as places of exclusion. I suspect that it would be, I mean, I find it very hard to imagine the existence of a capitalist system without a system of borders. You know, borders in a way are just part of the violence of the existence of the state that we tend to forget too easily.
In terms of your understanding of the relationship between the state and the capital, do you tend to think of the nation state generally? Is that the scale of what you're thinking about? And is that something that makes a more inherent relation between state and capital? Because I'm thinking, what about other scales of the state, for example, the local state? Is that a place where it's more possible to become different? Whether we can see more separation between the state and the capital. And for example, I was thinking about the examples of some cities in Spain which are now being run by grassroots movements. Do you see that a bit more space of doing things differently at that scale, or do you see that as just part of the state in the general sense?
Yeah, I don't want to, I mean, when I say that I think what the Greek crisis shows is the limits of what you can do through the state. I'm not saying that you can't do anything through the state. I would actually, if I'd been in Greece and if I'd been eligible to vote, I would have voted for Syriza in January. I think that there are probably some perhaps minor things that they did introduce. They certainly changed the climate of discussion and the climate, you know, the image of what might be possible. When I was there a few days ago, I learned that they'd actually done less than I had thought that they had done. But they did, yeah, great. No, I mean, they could, at least in the first few months, I think, make some changes. That will probably, you know, I suppose I have this idea that left-wing governments, that there's a kind of honeymoon period where they may actually do interesting things. Means that it would be worth supporting them or voting for them, but that the honeymoon tends to be very short, and that after the honeymoon is over, they become more and more repressive and more excluding. You know? At the level of the local state, Yes, I think that as well there, yeah, you can, I'm sure that local states can do things, or local councils or can do things, but they will tend to come up against limits, you know, which may, you know, but yes, I mean, if we think of, well, how do we change the society, then people have always, I mean, I certainly don't want to say, well, the orthodoxy is, I don't want to create an orthodoxy or to say, well, you know, I have the answer, I don't, you know. And people try in all sorts of ways. And what we are learning about all the time, I think, is the possibilities and limits of those ways. You know, and the Syriza debacle was really a very dramatic illustration of the limits of what could be achieved at the level of national politics. And I think it was a lesson that we have to understand as not being just relevant to Greece, but really relevant to any national state. But this is, and I think coming back to the earlier one about the elections and the, you know, the Popular Unity Party, I think, because talking to people in Greece, I mean, some people were saying, well, no way would they vote on the 20th of September, and some were saying, well, they would vote for the Popular Unity Party really as a way of saying no. But if you think of, well, what could it actually do, it obviously won't get more than a small percentage. If by some miracle it won the election, what could it do? The best that it could, the best possible aspiration it could have, I think, would be to bring about a different restructuring of capital in the way that the Kirchners did in Argentina. No? But that's still a restructuring of capital, with all the nastiness that involves. So I don't see that.
Yeah. I'm still, whilst I've enjoyed what you said, perplexed by approaching the courage of our absurdity, and would like to know what road you would suggest that means going down, because it seems to me that seems a long way off. And we're faced with immediacy. And the immediacy is, well, we can get the Syriza from the state, we'll have Golden Dawn running the state instead. And where does that leave us? So it does seem to me that, do we have this luxury of time and deliberation? And don't we have to, therefore, the more short-termist options rather than think, well, I'll stop abandoning that one dream, otherwise maybe we'll never get there.
No, I think by the courage of absurdity, I really mean two different things. Firstly, I think in the present situation, okay, it seems that there was this great no on the 5th of July that was then flattened by the yes. And I'm trying to say, no, this great no was a massive no. Let us try and think from there. Let's try and think from that starting point. Okay, it was beaten down, it was flattened, but it is still in the air. It wasn't completely contained. So how do we work out from there and think about politics? And I don't think the answer is to say, oh, it's all over, we'll now accept the reforms. No, you think, well, how do we keep that no alive? And we keep that no alive in resisting all the austerity measures, in trying to think, well, we have to go on trying to create alternative ways of living. We have to go on with our community gardens, with our alternative agriculture, with whatever, no? So I mean that on one hand. And the other thing I mean by the courage of absurdity, I think, is actually what we do in the universities. It reminds me of an article by Horkheimer on traditional and critical theory, where he says, well, You know, one of the things that makes our lives difficult as critical theorists, or as professors who are critical theorists, is that nobody takes us seriously, you know, because it doesn't fit into their concept of science, it doesn't fit into their concept of rationality. You know, in that sense, I'm saying, well, no, we must have the courage of our own critical stance. We must have the courage to say that it is important to think about society from the perspective of a society that does not yet exist. And that means, for example, understanding categories as being the conceptual forms that express historically specific forms of social relations. And that seems to me, I suppose, just personally, or I suppose, as, that you always live on the edge of self-doubt. I mean, no, you, at least I feel that, no? That you always think, well, maybe all this is crazy, all this kind of being radical professors or lecturers or students is just crazy. There isn't an alternative. What are we talking about? You know, and the agreement of the 13th of July says to that to us, it says, well, there isn't an alternative. What are you talking about? No. And we have to say, well, no, we don't exactly see how we're going to get there, but to think means to think against this current rationality. You know? So courage of absurdity and our confidence, yes, in that sense. No? You know, what are you all doing here tonight? You know, really, why spend your time here? You could be doing far more productive things, creative things.
Don't you think Brexit would work? It would be better than what they've got at the moment. They'd still need capital, I agree, and they'd still need to make compromises. But the compromises they have made over the agreement with Europe are horrendous. No Greek person is going to own anything. But, you know, everything is going to be owned by people elsewhere. Yeah. So surely Brexit would be marginally better. At least there would be space, there would be freedom to some extent. And there would be dignity.
Again, if I were Greek, I'm not sure what I would do in this election. I'm not sure whether I would simply say, no way am I going to vote again, or whether I would vote for the Popular Unity Party, which supports Brexit. But I think if I voted for them, then it would really be a way of saying no. Just simply that, no. Once you start to say, but then I know that if they won, they would have to develop a plan B. They would have to develop, you know, the question of, well, how are we going to attract capital if we move out of the euro? How do we deal with that? And that would turn them inevitably, I think, these really committed, really genuine left-wing politicians, it would turn them into being oppressors, because they would have to repress demonstrations against privatizations. They would have to introduce labor reforms. They would have to come into conflict with the trade unions, etc. I think maybe it would be better.
It would be marginally better.
It would be, might be.
Margin would be enough to give them some kind of dignity.
Ah, that's what I'm afraid of. I don't think so, because, no, I think it could be marginally better, but I think that dignity is really a process of saying, no, we will not accept a system that we know and everybody knows threatens the existence of the human race. We will not accept a system that constantly and systematically makes the rich richer, increases inequality. We will not accept a system where money rules where profit rules. I think that for me is what dignity means. So to say, well, we won't restructure capital through the euro, we'll do it through a new drachma, would be to abandon dignity and actually to create a new government that would fairly quickly become repressive. That's what I think. On the other hand, it might be better, or it might be worse.
The chance is something of hope.
Yeah, but I think that the Greek drama.
I understand what you're saying about the analysis of what a new government in an independent Greece would have to do. Yes, they would have to do some of that, but at least there would be a hope that they wouldn't have to. It wouldn't have to be as bad as what they were having to do at the moment.
Yeah, perhaps.
And if it isn't, then no worse.
It would still. Ah, no, that's right. But I think that I suppose what I'm saying is, I want to say is that this kind of drama between the 5th and the 13th of July actually puts on the table not the option between euro or Grexit, but the option between capital restructuring and bye-bye capital. And that is what somehow we have to take on board, even if we don't know how to answer it. Even if Grexit might possibly be better for the moment. Fine, but we still know that there'll be another huge crisis.
Yeah, well, we know that already.
Exactly. Okay, so let's confront. Here it's actually placed on the table, no? Where they're saying, well, this is what capitalism means. What do you do about it?
You don't think the knock-on effect to the rest of Europe would have been an effect?
That would be worth it.
If they had left Europe.
I think that they probably should have. I think that he should have said no, he should have resigned, I think he should have called their bluff, absolutely. But that is in terms of the dignity of saying no, which is different from the indignity of saying we will reconstitute capitalist domination on a different basis.
Okay. Take a really quick question, quick answer.
Yeah, and then.
Yeah, very quick. I start from the Zapatista way of saying that where we build from below, they destroy from above, and with they mean the capitalists. And in the last part of your speech, you mentioned this tension between daily practice, our daily lives, and capitalism, which is becoming ever more involved in contradictions. So it becomes fragile on one hand, but more despotic on the other. And because also you said we are the crisis of capital, I just wonder if you see in these times this polarization increasing, that is, the demands of capital and our daily life. I mean, for ourselves, I mean, developed countries like UK or mainland Europe, obviously this, in many other cases, it's already a reality that capitalism is disrupting daily life of people like in Syria or Russia. Yeah.
No, I think so. I think it's... I mean, one thing that Christine Lagarde said, a couple of years ago, I think, when the Greeks complained about the terms of the agreement, she said, well, I don't have much sympathy with you. You're better off than the countries in Africa. No? And I think there is that. I mean, there is part of the process now is to say, well, okay, we've got a relatively prosperous part of the world, or where some, there's a prosperous tone at least. But we can let Greece go from that, And if I tend to think of, Greece has been in crisis for 5 years. Mexico has been in crisis or slow growth now for 20, 30 years. And you see what happens. in social disintegration, violence, drugs, unbelievable levels of repression, the horror of the 43 students of Ayotzinapa. That's what it means. The answer, since we're stopping, answer, two answers. I think, I would say three answers. I think firstly, that we do actually have to confront the question of how, take seriously that what is on the table is the option between capitalism or not capitalism, but accept that we don't yet have the strength to build a not capitalism, and we're not sure how to do it. Which leads me on to two sayings of the Zapatistas. No? Firstly, we walk, we do not run, because we are going very far. And secondly, asking we walk. That is the way we go forward. Okay. Thanks very much indeed.